Thank you. This morning's platform titled Climate Change, An Ethical Journey with Jeff Berardelli. Jeff is a meteorologist and climate change communicator for CBS News in New York City. Last year, driven by moral and ethical desire to use his platform to educate the masses on climate change, he left his full-time job as chief meteorologist in South Florida and embarked upon an experiment of sorts. With no means of employment, he moved back to New York City to attain his graduate degree in climate from Columbia University and work on compelling the TV broadcast media to cover climate change as an important issue. Jeff views the mass media as a vital medium in educating the public on the risks and opportunities posed by the climate challenge. And in this capacity, he's working now. And I'm very, very pleased to welcome him to share his journey with us this morning. Please welcome Jeff Berardelli.
Thank you, Monica, for inviting me. I'm honored to be here. I'm extraordinarily excited about this opportunity. I'm going to move off this microphone for a second. You let me know if you can hear me well. Okay. Can you hear me without a microphone?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm not going to use the mic. I'm Italian, so not only do I need to move my hands, but I need to move around. I can't do it without one. So
it won't be recorded well.
Oh, it won't be recorded. Okay. All right, so I'll move back over here. Okay. All right, I can still move my hands. What's this? Oh, look at this. This is very high tech. Okay, all right. First of all, love Carl Sagan, so I thought I would put a little quote from Carl up there. I was at Cornell University when he died. I was there in the mid-90s. And he lived right across the gorge from me, and little did I know that, you know, because at the time I was a fraternity guy, beer drinking fraternity guy, so I didn't quite appreciate the fact that that Carl Sagan was living literally, a stone's throw, I mean a stone's throw from where I was at Cornell. All right. Okay, so, you know, I'm going to spend time today, I'm getting a real mic. Okay, good. All right, very nice. Is this going to be on video?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, I can do it. Yeah. I use these all the time, so I should be able to figure this out. All right. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
On this mic?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay. So, this is going to be about climate change, but it's also going to be about my personal journey and my wife's personal journey. My wife loves being called out. She's very much an extrovert, as you can see by that smile. No, it's the opposite of that. So let's begin. Yes, that is Herb Jakowski. That's Mr. G. So when I was like 3 years old, I decided I wanted to be a weatherman. And I lived in Staten Island, so I lived in New York City. And he was my idol growing up, and I became one of his weather breakers. Remember Mr. G used to have weather breakers many, many years ago? He worked on Channel 2. So I wanted to be a weatherman my whole life. And I became a fashion icon when I wore that suit back in the 1990s. I'm pulling that back out of retirement, baby. Okay? All right. So here's what I've been doing. I'm going to Columbia University, and I've been working as a contributor for CBS News here in New York, and that was part of the plan many years ago. I worked on and off for CBS for 20 years. I worked at Channel 2 back in 2003 to 2007. I was a weatherman for them. But then I moved to Florida for 12 years, and I wasn't that engaged with climate change. My last job was chief meteorologist at West Palm Beach. Before that, I was in Miami, and I was living on Miami Beach watching all the crazy, you know, sea level rise issues that we were having on Miami Beach. That was when I was covering Hurricane Irma. So it was an eventful time at times, but I started feeling like I was part of just kind of this corporate hamster wheel. And although I actually like South Florida, I can't say the same for my wife, who is from South Florida, born and raised, and she was dying to get out of there. But I thought when I took that chief meteorologist job, because most of us work our whole lives to get a chief meteorologist job, it's a very high paying job. You know, you can set a community, you can be there for 30 plus years, I thought I would sail off into the sunset. But every single day I would pray as I ran in West Palm Beach, as I run outside every day. And every day I think to myself, how did I get so lucky in life? I have a wonderful, beautiful wife. I've lived a great life. I lived in Miami, I lived in New York, I went to Cornell. I had this great job, you know, being a weatherman, making all this money as a weatherman, which I think is great, I think it's wonderful, but I was giving back. I spent years giving back. I always tried to give back. But I also felt like I wasn't quite able to make the difference in the world that I wanted to make. Even though I had a platform, it was a West Palm Beach platform at that point, and I needed to reach out a larger audience. So every day I would pray that I would be given an opportunity to truly use whatever assets I have, whatever talent I have, whatever experience I have, whatever goodness I have, whatever I have, to give back to the world. At the same time, I had a relentless Floridian wife who did not want to live in Florida anymore, who, as you can see, absolutely hates the snow. So I'm sure she told me about, look at those cheeks. You see how red her cheeks are? Everybody, look at those cheeks. Sorry. I don't know if there's anybody's couch that I can sleep on tonight. We'll talk. I was searching for deeper meaning, you know, and I didn't want to just be a part of a corporate hamster wheel where I was just there to bring ratings in and just make money for the corporate machine. I didn't want to do that. I don't mind making money for the corporate machine because it employs all of us, but I want to make sure I'm also making a difference at the same time. So at this point, I had to put the pieces of the puzzle together in South Florida. How was I going to make a difference? Make my wife happy, not be part of this corporate machine. What could I possibly do in the world to make a difference? Well, this was the parking garage of a building I lived in South Beach. And during high tide cycles, and it's been happening a lot this past month, water will come up through the sewer system because it's salt water. It comes in from the ocean. That's why you can't build a wall around Miami. The water comes through the aquifer up through the ground, and that's the result. So I ate that octopus, which is good. At least I put it to good use. I'm kidding. I didn't do that. But that's the reality in Miami Beach. So it was clear to me in my personal life, as I lived on Miami Beach, I'm in a condo there, and through my work that we were having big climate issues. Ocean heat content. By the way, you always hear people talk about surface temperatures. Don't pay any attention to that. It goes up, it goes down every year because of El Nino. What really matters is what's happening in the ocean. And as you can see, there's no hiatus. It doesn't go down. It just goes straight up. And every year, we see a record ocean heat content. Every single year, we get a record. So basically, all that heat that we're storing in the atmosphere is getting stored in our oceans. That's the most important chart. The surface temperature going up and down every year is just a news item. That's what matters. Because almost all the energy is stored in our oceans. Our oceans are huge. Well, this is the bottom line. I love this cartoon. Yes, the planet got destroyed, but for a beautiful moment in time, we've created a lot of value for shareholders. So we need to check. Yeah, people are laughing, but it's not funny, right? But it's true. So we have to change our priorities around, don't we? I mean, that's what we're all sitting here for. So this is something I realized, that the media was ignoring climate change. I just wrote an article for Yale Climate Connections. I encourage you to check it out. But one thing I discovered was in 2018, only 55 of 16,000 total minutes of evening news airtime on ABC, CBS, and NBC was dedicated to climate change. In contrast, 28% of those news minutes was dedicated to President Donald Trump. Okay? And think about the disaster. Well, when I say disaster, think about the climate disaster that's going to be coming our way over the next couple of decades and how our children and our grandchildren are going to have to deal with this and how we're starting to have to deal with it now. Well, this is the case, that simple, clear messages repeated often by a variety of trusted sources get through to the public. And meteorologists have that platform. And that's when I put it together. I'm a communicator. I'm a meteorologist. I know a lot about climate change. I have a background in that. And because I worked in New York, I have probably some contacts in New York where I could actually figure out a way to get in and make a difference in New York with the big media. So, and I worked for CBS on and off for years, so I still had some contacts at CBS News. So what I did was they set up a meeting with CBS News 3 years ago, like 2.5, 3 years ago, and with someone in middle management. And they were in charge of CBSN, which is their 24-hour streaming service. 2 years, I'm going to see if I can just figure out a way to get media to do more climate change. He said, well, why don't you start doing climate change for us, but do it from West Palm Beach? So 2 to 3 times a week, I would send a climate report through fiber optics to CBSN in New York. And so that's how I got my foot in the door at CBS while I was still at West Palm Beach, under contract with another company. Did that for 1.5 years. And I didn't charge them because I knew if I charged them, that they would stop doing it. If they saw it on their ledgers, they would be like, why are we hiring this guy to do climate? Instead, I did it for free, 2-3 times a week, every day for 1.5 years so that I could get my foot. Right? And I was able to slide climate through the side door at CBS News without having to do it from the top down. So I essentially was able to get other people at CBS News excited about climate change doing that. You might have seen those stripes. I don't know if you've seen them. This was a stripe campaign from Ed Hawkins, who is a climate scientist in the UK. And basically, it's a simple concept that I used to get meteorologists from all over the world to wear ties and earrings and, you know, sport coffee mugs and so on and so forth to raise awareness on climate change. And that was kind of my big campaign intro to. Somebody actually did that. That's not a joke. That's someone's actual car, Tesla. So that's not mine, unfortunately. So this was my announcement in West Palm Beach that I was leaving. I'm not going to play it for you because, you know, we have somewhat limited time. But basically, that's when I announced that I would be moving to New York to get my degree in Columbia and at the same time see if I could figure out a way to get the media to take climate change seriously. Hopefully, I can get past that. Okay. So this is on my way up to New York City with my wife. It turns out this was Richmond, Virginia. I figured that out yesterday. We were on our way up. We took the leap. We didn't have a job. But here's the amazing point, is that I did this for the right reasons. I felt compelled that I was being pulled in this direction. And as we were driving up, I got a call from Channel 11 saying, hey, would you like to be a fill-in weatherman for us, WPIX? So at that moment, as I was driving through Georgia, actually, we got assurance that we would have at least some financial support to do this, that we would have some money coming in to help pay the bills, because neither one of us had any jobs coming up here at all. So that was, and it's amazing, right? I mean, I'm driving up, and I get that, I take that huge leap, my wife and I take this huge leap, but then we're rewarded for doing so almost immediately. So that was great. All right, so what does the public think of climate change? About 6 in 10 Americans think that climate warming is mostly due to human causes. That has gone up a little bit, and denial has gone down a little bit, which is good. Same thing with, is it an important issue to you? That's gone up. I was recently on Face the Nation here, which was wonderful. About 1 year after I moved here, almost exactly 1 year, I was invited to speak on Face the Nation, so I had made some very good progress in about 1 year's time with CBS News as a contributor there. I won't play that for you either. But you can find it. But here's the problem that we have right now, is look at conservative Republicans. They have not moved. Nor have moderate Republicans either. So that's the issue we have right now. It's become such a partisan issue. What determines a person's beliefs? It's not just information. So you can throw as much science as you want their way. It's never going to change their mind. It's because very much our opinions are formed by our ideologies prior to the information. Some people can take that information and reform ideas about the way things work. Some people can't. Here are the reasons behind, you know, skepticism. I will tell you that oftentimes for people that are very conservative, they do believe that the words climate change are just a proxy for socialism. They truly believe that there is an agenda, and it's true, and I've talked to some, you know. So that's the reality. So it's very much threatening to them. And so kind of, you know, trying to scare them, fear tactics doesn't work, science doesn't really work either. So these are the reasons behind skepticism, solution aversion. These solutions to climate change may mean higher taxes, may mean bigger government. It conflicts with a pre-existing ideology, or it's at odds with friends of theirs, co-workers of theirs, other groups that they belong to. This is a great video that I would totally recommend that you watch. It's Ed Maybach. He's wonderful. So is Catherine Mahalo. I'm sure you've heard of Ed about Catherine. But what does everyone agree on? They agree on renewable energy. So So that's something that I'm going to bring up in a second. I also want to show you that the amount of people that are concerned and alarmed has gone up fairly decently over the past couple of years. So I'm going to give you some recommendations on kind of bridging the gap on climate change. You don't try to convince contrarians. More science makes them further entrenched, and you'll be wasting valuable time that you could be using in some other way. Talk about solutions, but more importantly, don't talk about them as solutions. Talk about them as opportunities. Because what generally conservatives respond to is economic development. And inherently, as we start to focus our attention on fixing climate, there's going to be a lot of jobs that are created. Now, this probably would create a little bit of controversy in a room like this. But the bottom line is that there are a lot of jobs that are going to be created because we're going to have to mitigate and adapt to climate change. It's just the reality. So if you talk about it in those terms, you're much more likely to actually be able to bridge the gap with conservative folks. Now, some people don't even think that, you know, we should try to convince the unconvinced. And I go back and forth on that. But right now in Congress, to get anything passed, you absolutely need to have some Republican votes. And so if you're going to soften up the stance against climate change on that side, it's talking about economic opportunity that's important, I think. And more so, concentrate on low-hanging fruit. So convince the concerned and cautious to take action. So the people that are already kind of on the fence, that are kind of worried about it, those are the people to motivate to write your congressperson, to get out and strike, whatever it is. Those are my recommendations to bridging the divide in America. All right, I want to play this video for you. So remember, my wife and I decided to do this. We didn't have any means with which to make money when we got here. I did have some financial stability because I had worked for a long time and saved some money. But it was still a big leap because I was leaving a really big job with a very good salary that I could have done for 30 years, I was very well established in that market. But this was my goodbye speech, a very impromptu goodbye speech that I want to play for you. And I think I actually have the name of the play.
Grassroots interest in doing climate change at CBS News.
to get them to do climate change. And as you probably have seen, CBS News is doing a lot of climate change. But here's the good news. As of today, I was promoted at CBS News. I'm now a full-time employee. I am CBS News meteorologist and climate specialist. And I say that, you know, because this has been it's only been a year and a half journey for me so far. Well, I started years before, you know, that, doing climate stuff for CBS News. But, you know, I'm glad I'm here today. I don't think it's a coincidence. For me, it's more of a synchronicity, because this is the reason why I took this journey, and this is the day that I was promoted to the exact job that I had envisioned years ago, which was figuring out how to work at CBS News, get climate change out in the mass media, and try to do my best to educate people on what's going on. And so for me, this is very much a validation, but more importantly, it's my way of showing, hopefully, other people in the world that if you do the right thing, that the world really can be good to you, that if you do the thing that you're best at, you give back to the world in the best way that you can, that you really can make a difference in the world, and it can work out for you too. It's living life with purpose, purpose-driven life. So that's my speech.
From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple and mother, every mother and father, orphan child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on the mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that in glory and triumph they can become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more commonly with one another and to preserve and cherish the blue dot, the unknown.
is an evangelical leader in science. She's the head of Texas Tech's climate program. I believe it's Texas Tech. It may not be, but Catherine Hayho? Yeah. She's one of the best scientists, one of the best climate scientists in the country, but she's also an evangelical Christian, and she's married to an evangelical pastor. And, you know, in that community, she is doing her best to try to change minds, hearts and minds in that community. As you can imagine, it's not particularly easy because they don't believe that climate change is necessarily a big issue, or that it, in some cases, that it's happening. So she's definitely a leader in that, and she's able to reach people that other people can't because she's one of them, and she lives in that community, so they trust her. The other question was the challenges for television versus you know, newspaper. Well, first of all, you know, to get a climate story on the evening news is tough. There's only 20 minutes of content on the evening news. It's only a 30-minute show. When you're the New York Times, you have unlimited amounts of space on your website. Now, CBS News will do a lot more climate change on CBSN, which is our digital arm, because it's 24-hour news, and which is why CNN, you know, should be and can be doing more on their source, because they're a 24-hour news station. So that, I would say, is the biggest thing. One of the problems with media is that we need visuals, right? You can cover, the New York Times can cover a financial story about climate change, but how do we do it on television when perhaps a financial story is not very visual? We won't do it unless we have good pictures. So that's another big challenge for us. We have to go to the ends of the earth to shoot video. It costs a lot of money. So I would say that that's been a challenge. But what I will say is, through the Covering Climate Now initiative through Columbia Journalism Review, they've gotten about 400 media sources on board to do a lot of climate coverage, which is why you've seen so much climate coverage over the past few months, in addition to obviously the children being a really compelling story. All right, so with that said, are there any questions? Yeah.
Yeah, there's a problem for drawdown, and I'm wondering, drawing down the CO2 emission, and I'm wondering if you know how that's working out.
Well, actually, I think Monica could speak better to that than I could. I don't work directly with drawdown, so I don't know how effective it's been, but the book has been extraordinarily effective. It's been one of the number one, if not the number one, climate books ever published. So, yeah, solutions are definitely something that we need to talk more about rather than fighting over causes, because at this point, you either believe it or you don't, but maybe the next step is solutions. Yeah.
One thing that, it's so hard to talk about this stuff, like, you know, I put together a great big climate check, and, you know, this is not rocket science, it's steam engine science, but still, without a visual, it's tough. I mean, I know the work of Dr. Jim White points to, you know, you add a degree Celsius, you get about 20 feet. The work of Dr. Eric Rigaud and others identifying the compromised pinning points in the, you know, marine ice shelves that we're committed to 15 to 30 feet sea level. Mm-hmm. Observation of the pedal record agree. How do you put that into a story to people, you know, just something in their 20s or 30s, this is going to cost you.
Yeah.
Or to planners, yeah. We're going to have to retreat. You know, I'm also a bird nerd, and like, you know, our community, like, don't spend $5 million buying something to protect a rare orchid in Massachusetts, because it's going to be cheaper.
Yeah.
50 years. So to get that kind of pocketbook, get it with the pocketbook.
Well, okay, so you have to meet people, but that's the thing. It's not a one-size-fits-all solution. You have to meet people where they are. If religion's important to them, then you need to speak in religious terms. If money is important to them, then you need to speak in money terms. If animals are important to them, then you need to speak in animal terms. If extreme weather is something they're concerned about, then speak in weather terms. The point is, it unfortunately is not a one-size-fits-all communication solution. But like I said, talking about opportunities, like, know your audience. And every audience, you should come in with a slightly different angle. Yeah.
Thank you for your presentation and your efforts here and your work. But nonetheless, there have been general critiques that the mainstream media, oftentimes when we have these cataclysmic weather events, doesn't give enough attention. maybe offer it to Bonnie, but what do you think it's going to take to get the media to do more and to center people like you at the front, and maybe even make you the news host?
Well, I don't. That wouldn't go down very well. That's not certainly not my forte. But me being there and more people like me being in newsrooms, now that I'm going to be there on a more consistent basis, it's going to be my job to build this from the ground up. So it's going to take that, and it's going to take me having allies within the news organization that are also interested in climate change. So that's kind of how I got to where I am at CBS News, and. You know, you need to have a mass, a critical mass of people within your organization that are really interested. You need allies. So that's how you do it. But there needs to be, you know, maybe soon there will be more of me at different news organizations. I took this chance, right? And it worked as of today. So we'll see. Yeah. So if by, you know, people who are more critical of climate change, if you're talking about people that are, you know, perhaps a little more conservative, one of the good things is that the younger conservatives, younger Republicans are a lot more concerned about climate change, and they're of the belief that it's caused by humans. It's mostly older Republicans. So it's changing on its own. And there's a group called the Young Evangelicals for Climate Change. They're young evangelicals, conservatives, and they're trying to push their own party to do more on climate change. And I believe that, you know, senators like Marco Rubio, who may not really care much about climate change, but realize that his constituents have to care about it because the sea level is rising and it's swallowing up communities in Florida. So we're getting, you know, conservative support in places like Florida. Just simply because there's no choice. People know it's happening. They can see it out their doors. So it's happening. It's going to happen a little more slowly. So the answer is you need to have people who they identify with talk to them, because you're never going to convince them. That's number one. And number two, concentrate on where you can make your greatest effort. So maybe that's mobilizing your friends in your community who actually already believe in climate change to get out there and do bigger and better work. By, you know, whatever it is. Yeah, that's usually what I would recommend. Yeah.
Jeff, thanks for this great presentation. I never had the opportunity of taking Carl Sagan's 101 astronomy, but I'm stuck in the big laboratory.
So you were at Cornell as well. And you never did take his class. When I got there, he wasn't teaching anymore. So unfortunately, I wanted to take his astronomy class. See, I didn't even see it. I was preparing for this. It was on CBS Sunday Morning. It's great. I sent a story like about a week ago on agriculture, and you know, you never know. It's funny. I'll send stories out, and they get used. So.
It's at 6 feet above sea level.
Yeah, record almost.
Well,
and so those are good stories, right? The Midwest farmer who may not believe in climate change but wants to help solve it. And that's what's happening. A lot of farmers are saying, let us be a part of the solution. Again, give them an opportunity to help. Don't fight with them over the details. That may help. And as far as Venice goes, it's a great story, great pictures, lots of art, you know, 1,000-plus-year-old, 2,000-year-old art that's in jeopardy. Good visual, good emotional story. Yeah. Not in the next few decades. It would take a couple hundred years. I mean, part of it's going to have to be us pulling carbon dioxide back out of the atmosphere through natural means like trees, but also probably technology, although that's not ready at all yet. I do, but it's going to take hundreds of years probably, at least a little bit more than a century. I mean, just because we don't know how strong the carbon capture technology is going to be, how fast it's going to proliferate. We know trees can probably accomplish maybe 30% of it or something, but what about the other 70%? We have to take the carbon dioxide back. We not only have to stop emitting carbon dioxide, we have to take whatever's out in there. We have to take it back out. That's really hard because economically it is very expensive and it is a really slow process and you need tremendous amounts of infrastructure all over the world. And if you can't make money off of it, who the heck is going to invest in it? So you need governments to do that. It's a long story, and I don't want to take up too much technical time here. Yeah. A scorecard on what, though, and who? So a scorecard on like how we're doing to combat climate change, or a scorecard on how the media is doing to publicize climate change? Or you want them to be able to vote on how the coverage is? You mean in terms of mitigating climate change? Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's a good idea to highlight places. I don't know about a scorecard, but certainly highlighting places that are making progress, right? That's what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Calling them out. That makes sense.
Like a tangible number to it.
Yeah, I could, like Costa Rica is getting an A grade, but, you know, the United States right now is getting a, and then maybe bring that down to the local level. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's a good point. Well, I think it is somewhat similar. When I had meteorologists from all over the world wear those ties and coffee mugs, those meteorologists are on TV and everywhere, Asia, Africa, Europe, South America. They do have some influence, but they need to be local leaders, you know, also. I mean, what I'm doing here is way beyond my job as a TV meteorologist. I'm actually working in an organization now trying to make systemic change within the media. Um, so So I think you probably just need that model, but in different countries where there's people have that have some knowledge and some responsibility to speak up on climate change that take the lead. But it's exactly that. I can't do it for another country. No one's going to listen to me. It has to be someone that's respected and well known that take on leadership roles. I think probably we, I don't know how much time we have. Yeah. Yeah, I think nuclear could be an option. The problem with nuclear is not whether it's safe or not. It's that it costs a lot more. Nuclear energy is a lot more expensive now than solar is, than wind is, than natural gas is. So just economically speaking, I don't see it being a part of the future, at least a big part. Can it be used safely? Yes, until something happens that we didn't expect, right? Until it's an earthquake in a place we didn't expect it, or a plane flies into it. So yeah, I mean, I generally think nuclear is relatively safe until that big, you know, until you have one big meltdown. But I don't even think that's the issue. The issue is it costs too much money. Everything else is coming down in price, and nuclear has not.
One more question.
Yeah. So a new technology in nuclear that may be able to reduce prices tremendously.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. That makes sense. It's a good point because, as you see, I'm not anti anything really. I try not to take too much of a stance just being in the media, but I just think we need everything. There's no silver bullet here. We need to do everything. We need to do everything. It's that big of a problem. So we have to throw the kitchen sink at the problem. I think that's it, right?
Thank you,
everyone. If you want